Good morning, students. Bio 102, lecture 10. This is lecture 10. Yay, we're almost done with the book. Today, we're going to look at the muscular system and the skeletal system, and what keeps us upright and all together and moving right along. The vertebrate skeletal system, we're going to look at that first. We're going to look at muscles. We're going to look at how muscles contract, and then we're going to look at the skeleton itself. All right, so the vertebrate skeletal muscle moves bones and the body, and it is characterized by a hierarchy of smaller and smaller units. And we're going to go all the way down to the smallest possible unit, and we're going to look at how does it work? How is this magic? A skeletal muscle consists of a bundle of long fibers, each a single cell, running parallel to the length of the muscle. Each muscle fiber is itself a bundle of smaller myofibrils arranged longitudinally. The myofibrils are composed of two kinds of myofilaments, and these are protein filaments. The thin filaments consist of two strands of actin and two strands of a regulatory protein, and the thick filaments are staggered arrays of myosin molecules. Muscle activity is a response to input from the nervous system. The action of a muscle is always to contract. Always, 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 always. Extension is passive. Skeletal muscle is also called striated muscle because the regular arrangement of myofilaments creates a pattern of light and dark bands. The functional unit of a muscle is called a sarcomere, and it is bordered by Z lines. And let me show you some pictures of all this stuff. So, first of all, let's look at a muscle. And then, if you actually teased out a fiber of the muscle, you would see that this fiber is composed of more fibrous looking longitudinal things. And those fibrous looking longitudinal things are actual single muscle fibers. But if you opened up one muscle fiber, what you would see is inside the plasma membrane are a bunch of protein filaments, bundles and bundles of them. And they are arranged in longitudinal fashion, and they're all called myofibrils. And if you looked at a myofibril, it's composed of little parts, teensy parts, called sarcomeres, stacked end to end. And we're going to actually look at where the magic happens. It happens in the sarcomere, which is in a myofibril, which is inside a muscle cell, one muscle fiber cell. And then all these muscle fiber cells are bunched up together as a bundle of muscle fibers, which ultimately becomes the muscle itself. So kind of cool, no? So when we look at this one part that is stacked up into the cell itself, we're going to look at the sarcomere, which is a unit, and it is bound. Why is it a unit? Well, there are these lines, and these lines are called Z lines, and they demarcate the end of the sarcomere. And if you looked at a scanning microscope picture, you would actually see the exact picture that is depicted in a cartoon version. But if you looked at this picture at the bottom, you see the Z line. Okay, so here are the two Z lines. And here, what you see are these two twisted ropes of thin filament or actin. And then you see this big fat filament called myosin, and it actually has heads on it touching the thin filaments. And what you see is a sarcomere with a whole, you know, empty spaces over here. What will happen is that this thick filament is going to drag itself to the end over here and the end over here. So this M line disappears. The two thin filaments actually start touching each other, and that is called a muscle contraction. And we're going to go through it step by step. This is called the sliding filament model of muscle contraction. According to the sliding filament model, filaments slide past each other longitudinally, producing more overlap between thick and thin filaments. The sliding of filaments relies on interaction between actin and myosin. And I really would like you to look at this link. It shows you this happening and you will love it because it explains it very, very clearly. And I'm sorry I cannot join you in this very nice brief animation. I'd love to, but this software that I'm using won't let me do two things at one time. So please pause the movie, the video, and watch the link and then come back to me, all right? And then, now that you know what that happened, and now you can see what a sarcomere is, and this actually shows you a contracting muscle. So this is a relaxed muscle over here, and so you see the Z lines over here, and then you see the thick filament here, and the thin filaments are in orange. And as the muscle contracts, you can see that the thick filaments are actually moving towards the Z lines, and when a muscle is fully contracted, what you see is the Z lines have actually moved from here to here, which is the maximum region it can actually go. So that is a fully contracted muscle. Here is a blow up of it, so you could see it a little bit better. And what you're seeing here is that this actin filament is almost going to touch it, but if you're really pushing hard, you can actually go past the M line, and you can go slightly overlapping each other. So how do muscles contract? And the head of a myosin molecule, this would be the thick fiber, binds to an actin filament, which is the thin fiber, forming a cross bridge and pulling the thin filament towards the center of the sarcomere. Muscle contraction requires repeated cycles of binding and release. Binding and release, binding and release. And every time you have a bind and a release, then you're using one ATP. Glycolysis and aerobic respiration generate the ATP needed to sustain muscle contraction. All right, so here we see it. So if we go from, so this is non-animated version. You start over here, and so you have thin filaments, which are these little round bead-like structures that are twisted. And then you have the thick filament, which is in the center, and it's a big rope with the head sticking up. And if you actually blew it up, you would see the thin filament, as indeed a twisted strand of pearls or beads, and then the thick filament with long striations and a head. And this head is a myosin head. And right now it's in the low energy configuration, which means it's closer to its filament. But once you add ATP to it, the myosin head is actually going to stick up. It's not going to be bent anymore. And it will go and join up to the actin filament. And that will, of course, require ATP. And then it will, as you can see from here, now we're going to go from 2 to 3. And what you see is a cross bridge has formed. So this is a temporary bridge. And it will then, the head will move forward. So the angle is now bent. All right. And so this filament, the actin filament, the thin filament, is what's really moving. But it seems like the thick filament is moving. But this will also require ATP, and you go back to the low energy configuration. So this is a cycle, and it repeats itself again and again. And there are regulatory proteins that control this. So there's a regulatory protein called tropomyosin, and the troponin complex, which is a set of additional proteins, and they bind to the actin strands on the thin filaments when a muscle fiber is at rest. And this prevents actin and myosin from interacting if it's not necessary. But for a muscle fiber to contract, the myosin binding sites have to be uncovered. So the tropomyosin and troponin complex has got to go away. This means that this is only going to happen when calcium ions are going to bind to the troponin complex and expose the myosin binding sites. And contraction will occur when the concentration of calcium ions is high, and the muscle fiber contraction stops when the concentration of calcium ions is low. The stimulus leading to contraction of a muscle fiber is an action potential in a motor neuron that makes a synapse with the muscle fiber. The synaptic terminal of the motor neuron releases the neurotransmitter acetylcholine. Acetylcholine depolarizes the muscle, causing it to produce an action potential. So here we are, we meet acetylcholine again, we meet a synapse again, and now we know that the concentration of calcium is going up and down, and so we know that that is controlled by calcitonin. So action potentials will travel to the interior of the muscle fiber along the transverse tubules, and the action potential along the T-tubules causes the sarcoplasmic reticulum to release calcium ions. So this is what will happen. The calcium is inside the muscle cell, the muscle fiber, but it's going to be bound to the sarcoplasmic reticulum, and then when it's released, it can go and bind to the troponin complex. The calcium ions binds to the troponin complex on the thin filaments, and this binding exposes myosin binding sites and allows the cross-bridge cycle to proceed. So here is a picture showing you this entire process. So we have a synapse here, and this is an axon of a motor neuron, and you actually have this muscle fiber here, and what you're seeing is these bundles. You see bundles of myofibrils. So here's a bundle, here's a bundle, all these bundles. And right around the bundles, you see a lot of mitochondria, because mitochondria are the ones that are generating the ATP, which is needed for all this work to be done. And then if you actually look at this sarcoplasmic reticulum, which is around, that is where the calcium is. And then you look at the myofibril itself, and what you see is, so this blue stuff, this tiny blue dots that are around the muscle fibril, the myofibril, that is the sarcoplasmic reticulum, which you see as these shapes over here. The sarcoplasmic reticulum has the calcium, and that is going to be released. And so what will happen is that it will go and bind to the troponin complex. Let's go look at it in a little bit detail in the bigger picture at the bottom. So first of all, we have this axon of the motor neuron. He's going to, at the synapse, send some acetylcholine. Got it. Okay, so we get this acetylcholine, and that is going to go to the sarcoplasmic reticulum and say, you know what, you need to release some of this calcium. And the calcium is going to be released, which will then, as you can see, these are the ions. And then they are going to go bind to the thin filament and expose those areas that are going to be used for moving the fiber, and the troponin complex is then exposed. This allows the head, the myosin head of the thick filament, to bind to the actin filament, which will move it forward, and then it will release it again, and the cycle repeats. So that's how this works. When motor neuron input stops, the muscle cell will relax. Transport proteins in the sarcoplasmic reticulum pump calcium ions out of the cytosol, and regulatory proteins bound to thin filaments shift back to the myosin binding sites. So the cycle gets complete. And I have one more link for you, because this is a little difficult concept to understand. Well, it's not really difficult, but the more animations you see, the better, the more sense it makes, the better it fits in your mind, and you can understand it a little bit better. So please do click on this link. Again, I cannot join you in that journey. I wish I could, but the software doesn't allow me to. So please pause the video over here, click on the link, watch it, and then start the video one more time and come back to me. So there's always going to be some control of muscles, yes? So there's nervous control. So how does this work? Well, contraction of a whole muscle is graded. And that means the extent and the strength of its contraction can be altered voluntarily. There are two basic mechanisms by which the nervous system produces graded contractions, varying the numbers of fibers that contract. So either not a lot of fibers are going to contract, so that's one way, or varying the rate at which the fibers are stimulated, so that's another way. Each motor neuron can synapse with multiple muscle fibers, although each fiber is controlled by only one motor neuron. A motor unit will consist of a single motor neuron and all the muscle fibers it controls. Recruitment of multiple motor neurons results in stronger contractions. A twitch results from a single action potential in a motor neuron. More rapidly delivered action potentials produce a graded contraction by summation, and we know what summation is by now. Tetanus. Tetanus is a very bad thing, but it's a state of smooth and sustained contraction produced when motor neurons deliver a volley of action potentials. So this is bad because we can't stop it, but the action potentials just keep on coming. So here is on the x-axis, what you see is time. On the y-axis, you see tension of the muscle. And the red line shows you what is going on with the muscle. So if there's one action potential, you'll get a single twitch, which you can see as an action potential going up and down. If you get a pair of action potentials, you would actually get, you know, a summation, and it'll be a bigger twitch. But if you get a whole series of action potentials and they're all acting at the same time, at high frequency, well, not the same time, but, you know, right after each other, they will all add up. So they sum up, and they keep summing up, and they keep summing up until you finally get to a point where you can't sum up anymore, and that's tetanus, and that's just sustained contraction. There are several types of skeletal muscles, each adapted to a particular function. They're classified by the source of ATP, powering the muscle activity, or by the speed of the muscle contraction. So you could have oxidative and glycolytic fibers, or you could have fast twitch and slow twitch fibers. So these fast twitch and slow twitch are for the speed of the muscle contraction, and the oxidative and glycolytic are the source of ATP. So let's look at oxidative and glycolytic fibers first. Oxidative fibers rely mostly on aerobic respiration to generate ATP. These fibers have many mitochondria and a really rich blood supply and a large amount of myoglobin. Myoglobin is a protein that binds oxygen more tightly than hemoglobin does. Now remember, hemoglobin, I did show you an animation of it. It goes in the lungs, it just opens up, it expands a little bit, tucks in a molecule of oxygen, closes back down, runs off to the tissue which needs oxygen, opens up again. So, you know, this is a very loose connection. Myoglobin, on the other hand, is where oxygen is stored. So because it's stored, then oxygen is bound a little bit more tightly. And glycolytic fibers use glycolysis as their primary source of ATP. So while oxidative fibers will have a lot of myoglobin in it, and a lot, which will hold oxygen a lot tighter, glycolytic fibers are not going to use aerobic respiration. They use glycolysis, which is something that happens in the cytoplasm, as you know. Glycolytic fibers have less myoglobin than oxidative fibers, and they tire more easily. So which ones are those? In poultry, light meat is really glycolytic fibers. And so when you eat the chicken breast, you're eating glycolytic fibers. And dark meat are the oxidative fibers, the ones that people don't usually like to eat because they're the thighs and the drumstick of a chicken. So that's dark meat, and that's oxidative fibers. And they have a lot of myoglobin. That's why they taste different. And they keep a lot of do a lot of aerobic respiration. Let's look at the slow twitch and the fast twitch fibers. Like, what are they? Slow twitch fibers contract more slowly, but they sustain longer contractions. Also, slow twitch fibers are oxidative. Makes sense. They need more ATP. Fast twitch fibers contract more rapidly, but they sustain shorter contractions. Now, fast twitch fibers are funny because they can either be glycolytic or oxidative, and you would think that they would be all oxidative, but they're not. And most skeletal muscles contain both slow twitch and fast twitch muscles in varying ratios. So the fast twitch muscles are actually kind of important. In addition to skeletal muscle, vertebrates have cardiac muscle and smooth muscle. Cardiac muscle is found only in the heart, and it consists of striated cells electrically connected by intercalated discs. So intercalated discs have a lot of calcium in them. Cardiac muscle can generate action potentials without any neural input. They're just supposed to do it on their own. In smooth muscle, found mainly in the walls of hollow organs, such as those of the digestive tract, contractions are relatively slow. So the contractions can be caused by stimulation from neurons in the autonomic nervous system. But the skeletal muscle, and now that is different. Skeletons are function in support and protection and movement. And the skeleton provides a rigid structure to which these muscles are going to attach. Skeletal muscles are attached in antagonistic pairs. Just like we have antagonistic hormones, muscles are always attached in antagonistic pairs. One relaxes and one contracts. So the actions of which pairs are coordinated by the nervous system. So let's look at some pairs. So in the human forearm, we have a biceps and a triceps. So if the biceps is contracted, the triceps is relaxed. The grasshopper has the same, I know it looks horrible, but it has the same idea. And so it has in its leg, it has, a muscle that extends. So that would be its tricep, you could kind of sort of call it. And then the one that flexes, which is its biceps. And so that's when you have extension and the triceps is now contracted, the biceps is now relaxed. And in the grasshopper, you see the same idea. The triceps is, or the, its extensor muscle is now bunched up, whereas the flexor muscle is now relaxed. So these always occur in pairs. There are several types of skeletal systems. In the three main types of skeletons are, there's a hydrostatic skeleton. So hydro means water, yes. And so it doesn't have any hard parts. That animal doesn't have any hard parts. It just has water. And because of water, it will be able to maintain a shape. Or you could have an exoskeleton where the hard parts are external. Or you could have an endoskeleton where the hard parts are internal. So let's look at each skeleton one by one. A hydrostatic skeleton consists of fluid held under pressure in a closed body compartment. This is the main type of skeleton most cnidarians and flatworms and nematodes and in annelids, so any kind of worm. Any annelids use their hydrostatic skeleton for peristalsis, which is a type of movement on land produced by rhythmic waves of muscle contraction. So here is one cnidarian. And what you see is one end is the head, the other end is the tail. Well, it has bands or segments. And in the segments, there's a circular muscle and the longitudinal muscle. So it's kind of very basic, but it does the job. So if one of the muscles is relaxed, like here, the longitudinal muscle is relaxed. It's contracted. Then the circular muscle is actually relaxed. But when the circular muscle contracts, then it gets larger, bunches up, and the longitudinal muscle is shown as relaxing. So and the animal will move this away. And this goes on segment by segment by segment by segment. And you can see the wave of this. So this wave now has moved this way. And ultimately it goes back again. And that's how the animal moves itself forward. Exoskeletons. Exoskeletons are hard encasements deposited on the surface of an animal. Exoskeletons are found in most mollusks and in arthropods. Arthropods have a jointed exoskeleton called a cuticle, which can be both strong and flexible. The polysaccharide chitin, which we looked at a long time ago, is often found in the arthropod cuticle. Endoskeletons. Endoskeletons would be the hard internal skeleton buried inside soft tissue. Endoskeletons are found in organisms ranging from sponges to mammals. So sponges, you know, you would think really low life form, but no. So you would be surprised sometimes by these creatures. A mammalian skeleton has about 200 bones. We're born with more bones, but they fuse as we grow up, and so we end up with about 200 bones. Some bones are fused, other bones are connected at joints by ligaments that allow freedom of movement. And here are our 200 bones, and they're all connected to each other. There are joints. There are several types of joints, like a ball and socket joint, or a hinge joint, or a pivot joint. Then we have the rest of all the bones in our body which are interconnected. We should take a minute to look at the joints. So the ball and socket joint is an interesting one, and it does exactly look like a socket and a ball going in it. And that we have on our shoulder. So our arm is attached to our shoulder by a ball and socket joint. So the arm has a ball on it, and it fits right into a socket into our body. Hinge joints, this would be our knees, for instance. We have the top part of our leg, which is actually like a hinge with the bottom part of our leg. And it does look like a hinge because if you did this, you know, you could rotate it forward and backward, but it doesn't do the same stuff as a ball and socket joint would do, which would give you, you know, complete rotation this way or this way, also rotation this way and this way. So hinge joints only allow you to move in a certain direction. And then there are pivot joints, and these will also just let you move in a certain way, so you can pivot away. So the hinge joint is between the humerus and the ulna, but the pivot joint is between the ulna and the radius, joining up with the with each other, so they can you can turn them. So when you actually are walking, so ulna and radius are this is how you turn your hand. So we're still on the arm, and you can turn it only because you have a pivot joint. Otherwise, you couldn't turn your hand from top to bottom. So that's why we have three joints right in our arms. An animal's body structure must support its size. So that's why we have skeletons. The weight of a body increases with the cube of its dimensions, and we saw this in the square cube law, while the strength of that body increases with the square of its dimensions, and we saw that too. The skeletons of small and large animals have different proportions. So in mammals and birds, the position of the legs relative to the body is very important in determining how much weight the legs can bear. So you notice that the birds have legs perched in a certain way, whereas our legs are not inserted in that way. So that's because we have different body weights. In water, friction is a bigger problem than gravity is. So fast swimmers usually have a sleek torpedo-like shape to minimize friction. And animals can swim in diverse ways. They can paddle with their legs and use them like oars. They can do jet propulsion, which is shoot out a jet in one direction and move in the opposite. Or they can undulate their body and tail from side to side or up and down. So they could do several ways. You could also propel your body in the air as flying. Active flight requires that wings develop enough lift to overcome the downward force of gravity. Many flying animals have adaptations that reduce body mass. For example, birds lack teeth and a urinary bladder, as well as large bones with air-filled regions. So they want to reduce the body mass so they can actually fly, because otherwise it would be very difficult. Let's look at the energy costs of locomotion. Well, it really depends on the mode of locomotion and the environment the animal is in, but it can be estimated by the rate of oxygen consumption or carbon dioxide production. Either one of those would do. Animals specialized for swimming expend less energy per meter traveled than equivalently sized animals specialized for flying or running. And so that makes sense. Swimming does not require as much energy than flying, which is very energy intensive, or running, which is also very energy intensive. Large animals travel more efficiently than small animals adapted to the same mode of transport. So this wouldn't be intuitive. You would think that large animals would maybe use a lot of energy, but they actually don't. Because they've acquired a larger shape, they can travel energy-wise, cost-wise, more efficiently than smaller animals if the mode of transport is the same, like legs or hooves or whatever. Here is a chart showing you the energy cost on the y-axis and the body mass on the x-axis, and it's a log-log scale. So this shows you what I just talked about a moment ago. So in swimming, as the body mass increases, what you're seeing is more efficiency, less energy is being used. So any big swimmer in the ocean is going to actually be more efficient in using its energy. Same thing for flying. So flying, what you're seeing is as you're getting to be a bigger size, you are actually going to be more energy efficient than if you were a tiny little hummingbird over here with a very small body mass. You're going to spend an awful lot of energy trying to fly. Same thing with running, same idea, a little bit steeper slope, but same idea. So as you get bigger, you can run a lot more efficiently than you could if you were running as a very small mouse or smaller creature. So I hope this is helpful. This would be all about locomotion and muscles and how we move ourselves from place to place. I'll see you next time.